the rest of our time on tips. So before I do that, do you guys have any questions about any of the things I just talked about? No? Okay, cool. So I am a very visual person, which is a good thing for your spectrum people, your kiddos. And so I have kind of color-coded these things for you, just as an example of a strategy that you might want to use either at home or within the classroom. The more visual you can make things, the better. So I'm going to give you some tips for emotion regulation, some tips for social emotional skills, some tips for homework, because I know that was a big headache, and then some classroom strategies just in general. So one of the things that I am extremely passionate about, other than my spectrum kiddos, is mindfulness and building skills just to use on a day-to-day basis. So one of the things that I think, I try to be very intentional about this, is, and this is very important for spectrum, is a lot of times if you tell them to do something, they're going to say, why? Right? They want to know the why behind it. And so I oftentimes am referring back to the brain and helping, you know, them understand their nervous system and just giving them information about the why I'm telling you to do something. So whenever you give a strategy or you're asking them to do something, it's typically nice to give them some sort of explanation associated with it. So this first strategy, our breath. Breathing is the first thing I teach when I start working with people, because you're always breathing and your breath is always with you, and it's probably one of your most powerful tools, and this is something that you guys probably just don't even think about, but when we take a deep breath in, and you can teach this different ways, but I teach it where you breathe in through your nose to the count of four, pause, and then you exhale to the count of six, and what's critical is a longer exhale. So when we do a longer exhale, that is going to help lower our body's nervous system and settle it down. And so that's related to essentially that fight or flight response that we have. We've got some different divisions there, but you can think of the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. And so this is getting at that relaxation piece, helping to settle. So one thing that I think is noteworthy related to breathing and related to mindfulness is that our minds wander all the time. And when we are practicing mindfulness, it's about being present in the current moment. And we're trying to hone in with our five senses. And when our mind wanders, we don't judge it. We just bring it back. And what's amazing is that the more we are intentional with practicing mindfulness, there are actual changes that occur structurally within your brain. So I will give you an example. So right now, like if you take a moment and just listen, what do you hear in here? Okay, so even in that brief moment, you were focused on the now, this present moment, right? You weren't thinking about what you have to do later. You weren't thinking about maybe traffic from earlier when you're driving here, right? And so just that intentional, purposeful focus on this moment is really powerful in terms of tuning us into what's going well. And then, you know, mindfulness is this muscle where the more you do it, the easier it becomes. So obviously that was just a quick little snippet, but you can practice mindfulness in all sorts of ways. You can do mindful eating, you can do, you know, you're in the shower, or your kid's taking a bath, and you get them to focus on how does that feel on your fingers? What's the scent that you're noticing? And I've spent a lot of time exploring different senses with my kids that I'm working with, because some kids love to do the different scents. I have like a little Tibetan singing bowl that my kids are obsessed with, because you can feel the vibration, and then that leads into a nice conversation about waves and frequencies, and then they go in their little science tangent. But so, you know, again, when we relate this back to the brain, so there is a part of your brain called the amygdala. And the amygdala is responsible for aggression and anxiety. And for adults who practice mindfulness every day, even 15 to 20 minutes, for 8 weeks, they did brain imaging before and after this 8-week period, they found that the amygdala actually got smaller, which is really wild when you think about it, because how hard was what we just did to do? Not very hard. And mindfulness has also been found to help with concentration and focus and attention, because we're trying to focus on kind of boring stuff, right? And so our mind is going to wander, and then we're going to just keep bringing it back. And so it's that purposeful redirecting back to whatever you're trying to focus on, whether it's your breath, whether it's your food that you're eating, you know, whatever it is. And then there's also some cool stuff that's coming out too in terms of another area. Mindfulness has been found to help reduce inflammation in the body. And we're starting to find that inflammation is associated with different mental health issues. And so there's lots of cool stuff that's coming out related to that. And so again, you know, the more we can engage our five senses, the more we can sit down and take time to do it. I love the Calm app. There's a great little section on body scans where you can do about 3 minutes, 5 minutes, sometimes you can pick how long you want to do it. You know, mindful listening is great for classroom strategy in terms of dinging a bell and trying to get them to identify, okay, well, when did you hear it stop, right? So raise your hand. And so again, you're getting them tuned in, and it's almost like they get a quick glimpse of like that calm while everyone's listening, and it's like, oh, and then they get excited when they don't hear it anymore. Related to, you know, another piece that's important is movement. I cannot tell you how important movement is for everyone in general, but especially for kids on spectrum. So when we get our heart rate elevated, when we are stressed, it is going to essentially trick our brain into thinking that we have neutralized whatever threat we were experiencing, whether it was real or perceived. So a classic example I like to give is when, you know, you're walking in the woods and all of a sudden you see a bear. So some people are gonna run like hell to get out of there. Other people might try to fight the bear. So you can probably find those startle videos on YouTube and seeing people jump and somebody punches somebody by accident. So you never know what your response is. But so essentially when we elevate our heart rate, when we're stressed, it's going to trick our brains into thinking that we either ran away from that bear or we fought it. So, another thing related to this too is when our kids are sitting still for long periods of time, their attention is going to go down. They're going to lose concentration and focus. So allowing movement breaks just in general is going to be helpful for focus. Another strategy related to this with stress is if you have your kid, you know, they're really upset, they're really anxious, get them to run up and down some stairs. Get them to go, you know, do some laps outside, or you know, just again, you're just trying to get that heart rate spiked. Yeah.
Can you go back to the point you had right before about exercise breaks and increasing attention?
Yeah.
Attention. How would you? I mean, if we want that, how do you action that? Is it in the classroom?
So I think it's more about creating those time periods throughout the day. So it's like, because again, bringing it back to their need to kind of decompress and unwind. You know, I think the transitions between classes are a great opportunity maybe to get them, not necessarily to be running up and down the halls by any means, but, you know, getting an opportunity for a movement. So maybe before they sit down at, you know, the next class period, they're all doing some jumping or something to kind of get them moving a little bit more. Obviously, recess is standard, gym standard. But I think, you know, just in general, the more, even if it's like yoga poses, you know, and that's not going to spike your heart rate per se, but when we do movement, it settles our nervous system regardless, because it's helping our body to regulate, it's giving us more sensory input, and so just movement in general is going to help with focus.
Well, if you find a study that shows the best way to use that in class,
mm-hmm.
we're doing a little thing for a fundraiser where we're doing some movement snacks and everything.
Yeah.
We would love to know how to do that.
Okay.
Because we can not only raise money, but then we can help the kids feel better along the way.
Okay.
So
yeah.
If you find it's like every 45 minutes they need to do 10 air squats or whatever it is.
Energize their schedule.
Right.
Yeah,
okay, so if we can, I'd love to hear about
that,
because then we can put it into the program.
Question about your hypo kinds of kids. So like my child can sit for very long periods of time and it's sort of a floppy guy, you know, and it's not particularly athletic. If he were to move more, it would still result in increased attention and just stamina.
It can. Mm-hmm. seems counterintuitive, right? Where if you've got this kid that's really sluggish, but think about kids that struggle with depression. So when you are forcing movement, it's going to help the brain secrete certain chemicals that are going to release those endorphins, those feel-good neurotransmitters. And so, you know, and I think what you have to be mindful of is that there are some kids where they're going to have a really dramatic effect from movement, and then there are other kids where it's not going to be as effective. So that's where you guys as parents are experts on your kids, and you're going to realize, okay, you know, this strategy may in theory be a nice idea, but not going to be realistic or appropriate for my kid. Because I always say what works for one person doesn't work for everyone, and that's why I give lots of different tools for the toolkit.
We're in the process of, like, should he start learning how to drive a car? And we don't feel that he's quite coordinated enough to do that, but like if he started some type of athletic activity, I'm wondering if there would be a correlation between that and, you know, the ability to sit behind the wheel and function. He's driving a golf cart, but that's been our starting point.
Okay, that's a good start.
We're like, let's do a golf cart first. So he's not a motor kind of guy. He's more of like a I'm hanging, kind of.
One thought too, in terms of, and again, it might be worthwhile to consult with an occupational therapist too. But sometimes when we can find ways to integrate the two hemispheres so left hemisphere is controlling right side of body, right hemisphere left side. And so when we can do activities that require both sides to work, that's going to strengthen that.
Because he's wanted to use both feet, left for brake and right for accelerator, and teaching him how to keep the left out of it, just right over, right, you know. So we've been doing some of our own things that it's very experimental.
Go-karts also.
And then just kind of in general, movement is a break, right? So taking breaks is so important. Again, they need that time to decompress. So listening to relaxing music, or just music that they enjoy, because when you think about it, music can either increase our energy. If we are listening to something fast-paced, exciting, it's got a good beat to it, you know, that's going to pump us up a little bit, as opposed to quiet guitar or nature sounds. And then temperature is another strategy to help regulate. So when you have a kid that is highly stressed, get them to hold ice cubes, get them to splash water on their face. And I think we can all relate to driving, and we're getting a little sleepy, and we crank that air up kind of cold. It's going to help us stay awake, versus when we get hot, it's going to help us settle ourselves down. So I always like to recommend, if you have kids that are struggling to fall asleep, to do baths or showers in the evening, because that's going to help regulate. And again, sleep is a whole nother talk in terms of things you should and should not be doing with light and all that stuff. So I'm going to not dive into that. But again, weighted items, using pressure. Sometimes I will encourage my kids to, with parent permission, rearrange room, because they are going to be lifting and moving those heavy things. And again, it's giving them more input. Distraction could be reading, could be art, any kind of enjoyable activity. And then again, if they need to take a break, they can have a physical exit card, you know, walking away, going to a safe person at the school or a safe place at the school if they need some time to chill. So again, there's lots of different strategies that we can consider for that. Regarding the emotion piece, now I think you guys would be surprised at how many kids on the spectrum, or just kids in general, really don't quite grasp the basics of what different emotions look like, what it feels like, how it feels in their body. Because even then, you know, we think about the intensity is a factor that's neglected as well. So, thinking of this little thermostat, or the thermometer here. So just because we have low energy doesn't necessarily mean that's bad, right? Just the same as if we have high energy doesn't necessarily mean it's bad. But emotions are the thing that dictates how we view that energy. So if we're really excited, you know, our high energy feels great. But if we are angry, that feels different, are stressed. That feels different. Same thing goes with when we're low energy. We might just simply be tired, or we're bored, or we could be depressed and very sad. So, you know, helping our kids understand that there is a range is really important. And then also, you know, with spectrum especially, you have got to help them tune in to the face. And it's uncomfortable, and so you can validate that for them and let them know that they're probably not going to want to look at you. Even then, sometimes what I'll do is kind of like a nice buffer is instead of having them make direct eye contact, I'll have them say, look at my ear, right? Because if you look at somebody's ear, it's closer to the eye. It's not all the way over here, but it's just a little bit closer. But it still feels off because, like, right now I'm looking at your ear. It doesn't look the same here versus here, right? So just another little kind of caveat.
Can I say something? Mm-hmm. It's just reminding me, and my son, Evan, said this morning, Mom, can you look at me in the eye when I'm talking with you? I'm like,
oh.
Wait a minute, I've never heard this in my life because I'm studying about 10 times a day. But then I was, and he couldn't look me back. But he wanted, like, picked up on the social cue that you need to be doing that because I want you to tune in. I really want you to hear this. But then I went to talk with him, it's like, tuck in here.
Yeah. One analogy that might be helpful in terms of, okay, so your kids are going to have to do things that they're uncomfortable with sometimes just because it's expected socially. But I always like to tell them that, you know, when we dip our toes in a pool, it's really cold at first and we don't like it. But what happens when you leave your feet in the pool after a period of time? You get used to it. Now, your kids may never fully get used to it, but at least it will be more comfortable as opposed to if you jump out of the pool and then you get back in, you're starting all over, right? The same thing goes with the movie theater. If it's blaring, loud, uncomfortable, and you walk out, as soon as you go right back in, it's gonna be really loud and uncomfortable. And related to that too, one example, and I don't know if I put this one in here or not, I probably didn't. There's a great, another metaphor, and again, for some Aspies, they will get the metaphor. Other Aspies, they won't, so use caution with this. But our thoughts and our feelings are just like the weather. So the weather is always changing. So, you know, what we experience in the morning may not be what's happening in the afternoon. And so it's, our discomfort is temporary. It's not going to last forever. Even then, the sky is never hurt by the weather. The sky always has room for it. You always can, you know, have this terrible storm, but the sky, nothing ever happens to the sky. And so if they think of themselves as the sky, they can handle it, right? And so that's building that resiliency muscle a little bit for them. So some specific things related to maybe how to talk about stuff. So oftentimes we immediately go into problem solving mode with our kids. And the reality is, first, we do want to validate how they're feeling. And so, you know, let them know, hey, label that feeling and say, you seem upset or you seem frustrated. What's up? And then you empathize and you can say, oh man, yeah, that must have been tough. And then you can drill for a little bit more. What bothered you the most about that? Or tell me more, you know, tell me more about what happened. So you're trying to get little nuggets. And then before you immediately try to solve the problem for them, try to brainstorm, have them come up with some solutions. You know, I've got some thoughts, but I want to hear what you think first. Or, you know, let's brainstorm, but you try. And so cause the more we can teach them about brainstorming in general, the better, because that's something that they'll have to figure out how to do on their own. But so there's some specific ways that we can kind of coach them in terms of helping them label that feeling, seeing that we get what's going on, and then trying to help them problem solve. Related, I feel statements. I know it sounds so simple, but it's so important. And you know, so the way to really kind of break this down is to think about I feel first, right? So what's the emotion? When you or this thing is, right? And then why you're feeling that way, and then what you want, right? So it's I felt upset when you laughed at my shoes because it hurt my feelings. I want you to please stop, right? So the more you can, again, give very concrete examples, practice. So styles are one of those things where, in theory, you can explain it, and they get it, and then they leave the room, and then they have completely forgotten it, everything you've said. And so you just have to really know that you are going to have to work hard with them and give them lots of opportunities to not necessarily be successful all the time. So related, I love this. So I want you guys to take a look at these lines. So which line is longer to you?
Do you guys think it's that one, that one, or that one?
The middle.
I think they're all the same.
So this is a trick. This is a trick. So they are all actually the same length, right? So what about this one? What do you guys see when you look at this?
Right.
What do you see?
Old lady.
Okay, so you see an old lady.
And there's the young lady.
Yeah. So here's the old lady. There's her nose. There's her mouth and her jaw. Maybe wearing a little scarf here. Versus here's the side profile of the young lady, right? So there's her jaw. There's her little nose and eyelashes. And so, you know, when you're looking at this from a different point of view, are either of those perspectives wrong?
No. Isn't that the one with the rabbit in it too?
Maybe.
Yeah. See the eye in the top right corner and then the ear that's
oh, I haven't noticed that. See,
there.
I love that.
I don't see a rabbit.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm gonna have to add that to my list now. But so when you do this, right, when you're looking at things from different points of view, you start to understand that just because you have a different opinion doesn't mean that the other person's opinion can't also be true or valid. And so it helps us know that this is something that's important to take into account when we're solving problems. Because maybe, you know, just as an example, your kid waved to a buddy in the hallway and they, you know, started to think, oh, well, this person doesn't like me anymore, right? Well, what else could have happened? Put yourself in that kid's shoe. Maybe they were distracted. Maybe they didn't see it. Maybe they are actually mad. Even then, okay, well, why would they be mad, right? What's your evidence for that? So you just kind of start trying to break it down with them. Another thing too, and I feel like a lot of schools, especially across Lawrence, are really good at this, you know, just kind of incorporating games and play. The more you can kind of practice that perspective taking, so would you rather blank or blank. Would you rather eat a chocolate covered ant? Or, you know, and so you can just kind of get as crazy as you want with it. You know, if you could have any superpower or any job or vacation, what would it be? Why? So we're not only communicating our perspective, kind of our rationale behind it, but we're also getting to see what others think, and so exposing to different opinions. You know, what made you feel whatever today? So, you know, you want to have them share a feeling, and I'll send these out to you guys too if that's helpful. You know, share an experience from the day, how it made them feel. There's some great research related to resiliency and overall well-being and flourishing, which is for three good things, right, and why. So, or what went well today, because a lot of times we drill for drama as opposed to focusing on what's good. So I realize I can talk forever about these things, so I apologize.